focusing on the current election, the last election, we have a sort of picture socially. Different people are gonna have different parts of it, but of what that interference looked like in 2016 based on reporting and the Mueller investigation and all of that. To what extent is it accurate, and to what extent do people have misconceptions about what form the interference took, what effect it ended up having? Have we learned any inaccurate lessons from the experience of 2016?
Yeah, so I mean, I think it's so unfortunate that the politics, the partisanship of our current moment have distracted from what Russia actually did, which is documented, which is established, and which is very straightforward. And I interviewed, to really get at the heart of that, 26 former advisors to President Obama, folks like John Brennan, Jim Clapper, Susan Rice, to really ask, okay, what did Russia do and what was it like to respond? And in brief, Russia did three things. One, Russia spread massive amounts of propaganda across social media platforms, reaching over 100 million Americans with its propaganda designed to sow discord and to advantage Trump over Clinton. Second, Russia stole and released the sensitive Democratic Party emails from the DNC and John Podesta and leaked them through WikiLeaks, which was just an online cutout. And third, Russian intelligence systemically targeted, probed, and penetrated our actual election systems, giving rise to the fear inside the Obama White House that Russia would actually seek to manipulate the voter data and vote tallies of US citizens directly. And as I detail in my book, that fear dominated White House decision making back in 16, but Russia, there's no evidence that Russia actually executed upon that capability, but rather they focused on manipulating millions of Americans through those stolen emails and through its propaganda across social media.
So looking to the current election, to the extent that Russia might be doing something like that, are they doing any of those three forms? I mean, we haven't had anything like the big trove of documents being leaked or anything like that. Or is there something else going on that doesn't necessarily fit the 2016 model?
So that's why history is so valuable, because the three forms of attack that Russia executed in 16 are just one instance of what Russia is actually capable of. In that Russia has shown various tactics in countries like Ukraine, France, the United Kingdom as to what it's capable of. And so moving forward, we shouldn't just assume that the only way for Russia to interfere is by doing what it did the last time. Because in fact, we've seen that Russia is actively interfering in this election right now. The FBI director has said under oath that Russia is very active in seeking to interfere in this election. We've seen Facebook and Twitter takedowns of Russian networks on social media. We've seen Microsoft reveal that Russian military intelligence is working to steal and presumably then release the emails of hundreds of American political figures. But we've also seen Russia amplifying discourse around mail-in voting, voter fraud, amplifying discourse around the mental health of Joe Biden, or allegations about it made by his opponent in Donald Trump. So Russia is adjusting for our current political environment, and the Russian tradition here, going back to the KGB, and as I detail extensively in my book, is to exacerbate vulnerabilities that already exist. So the best way to get at what Russia could do next is to look at ourselves. And high up on that list as to where we are as a country in terms of our own dysfunction is the widespread doubt about our ability to have a stable and fair voting process. And so we've already seen Russia spread disinformation about mail-in voter fraud. And I would fully expect Russia to continue to try to sow doubt, amplify doubt about whether this election is actually legitimate.
Yeah. Wow, that's amazing. So one last question, just because I have to ask. Looking forward, hypothetically, I mean, it doesn't look like Trump or the Republicans are really taking foreign interference super seriously in terms of, you know, putting a significant amount of new funding into fighting it or anything like that. But hypothetically, were Joe Biden to win, on the two sides, do you think it's likely that there would be a serious look at protecting and you know, protecting us from interference in terms of regulations on social media or anything like that? And then on the other side, where you talked about actually banning CIA covert, you know, influence in other countries, do you think that that's likely to be on the docket when the topic of election interference has been on people's minds for several years now?
So I hope so. I mean, I would say that where we need to be as a country is to remember that this threat is not partisan. The Soviet Union, as I detail in my book, targeted Republican politicians throughout the Cold War. They tried to take down Richard Nixon. They tried to take down Ronald Reagan. Now it just so happens that Russia is trying to help a Republican, but Russia's goals are to advance Russia's objectives, which are to choose our leaders for us, sabotage our democratic processes, and undermine the viability of the democratic model as a genuine and legitimate form of governance. And that should offend and serve as a call to action for all Americans. So I would say moving forward, if Donald Trump were defeated, whether it's in 21 or in 25, when there is a new president, that president should be launching a comprehensive policy response with both domestic policy components that include securing our infrastructure, renewing ourselves domestically in areas like local media and education, regulating social media companies, but also collaborating with them and expecting transparency from them, better managing and being less gullible to document dumps and getting at the polarization that makes us so vulnerable to this form of attack. But in conjunction with that area of domestic renewal, we have to renew ourselves abroad. We should be working with other democracies who are under siege by Russian actors in seeking to detect and deter Russia's operations to manipulate our elections, because we're stronger when we work together with our allies. And I was struck in my interviews with, for instance, the president of Montenegro, whom Russian intelligence tried to assassinate, that other democracies are struggling dearly to defend their electoral sovereignty and wish America were helping them do so. So I think we should not only be doing that, but as you said, as a necessary prerequisite to that, we ourselves should be banning this practice of covert electoral interference, because Americans might not remember this history, but foreigners do. And when I was interviewing foreign officials, they said to me, well, if Russia does it and America does it, who cares? It's all the same. And that's not true. A, there was not, I believe, ever an equivalency, as I elaborate upon in the book, between Russian and American covert action in this space. There are similarities, they're comparable, but not identical. But more importantly, we have moved away from this. So let's say so. Let's chart a new path where we help democracies defend themselves. We expose Russia's operations, but we don't get down in the mud with Russia. Because at the end of the day, that just plays into our adversary's hands in seeking to degrade democratic systems and undermine their very legitimacy. So I think the path forward will be hard, it will take work, but democracy is never the easy thing. And I think that there are steps that are available to us, both at home and abroad, to make this threat a much more manageable, much more contained problem, instead of letting it be open season, as it has been, for foreign actors to manipulate our democratic processes.
Well, the book is Rigged: America, Russia, and 100 Years of Covert Electoral Interference. I can only imagine with how much I just learned in this interview, how much someone can learn by reading the book. David Shimer, thank you for joining us today. Really do appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me.
For more political news breakdowns, interviews, stories of activism, and me trying my hardest to care about the occasional big celebrity news story, subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/thedamagereport. And you can ring the bell wherever it is so you don't miss anything.